In the last lecture, we dealt with several problems to illustrate how to use the concepts that you have learned so far. You see, it is always a good idea to solve examples so that whatever you have learned is that becomes fixed. In this lecture, we start with alternating currents, AC as it is called. Now, so far in electricity and magnetism, you have dealt with a current which is always in one direction. Say in this circuit, the current is always in this one direction. However, now we are going to use currents which are not always in one direction. For half the cycle, it is in one direction. For the remaining half cycle, it is in the opposite direction. Such currents are known as AC currents. And the currents which you have used so far, which are always in one direction, they are called direct currents or DC. So, we are now going to use AC instead of DC. Remember that AC is produced by a generator. Let me recall once again the arrangement here. We have a magnetic field, we have a coil which is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction, and these are the two slip rings with carbon brushes, and these slip rings are always in contact with the same arm of the coil, so that as shown here, the current goes through in the outer circuit in this direction. After the other half cycle, in the other half cycle, the current will go through this slip ring and will go in this direction, so that we have a current which is changing its direction. For this half, the current is in one direction. For this half, the current is in the opposite direction. This kind of current is known as AC. Once again, suppose this is a circuit. In an ordinary current, the electrons will always be flowing in one direction. Here, when the current changes direction, the electrons will flow in one direction for one half of the cycle and will flow into the opposite direction for the next half cycle. And why do we use AC? As I have explained earlier also, AC is something that can be stepped up in voltage or stepped down in voltage. So, at the power stations, if we generate AC, then it can be stepped up, transmitted, as we shall learn how to transmit the electricity from power station to the consumer. We shall see in this lecture or maybe the next one. And so, we step up the voltage of the supply at the plant, and then at the place of the consumer, we step it down to suitable level, so that there is no danger. So, that is the advantage of AC. DC cannot be dealt with in this fashion. At the end, where AC is given to consumers, the voltage is suitably stepped down. In India, outlets at our homes supply power at 220 volts and 50 hertz, that is 50 cycles per second. In some countries, notably USA, domestic power supply is at 120 volts and 60 hertz. It must be noted, however, that as far as the application of electricity to heating is concerned, it does not matter whether it is AC or DC. So, your bulbs which work on AC would also work equally well on DC. Now, the question arises that if electrons move in one direction in one half of the cycle and in the other direction in the next half of the cycle, then how does the current get established? See, electrons move for one half cycle in this direction. For the next half, they move in the opposite direction. So, how does the current get established? Instead of answering directly, let us make a simple calculation and explain how things work. We have already computed the drift velocity of electrons. It is about 10 to the power minus 5 meters per second, that is a few millimeters per second. In one half cycle, say 1/100th of a second. You see, in India, the supply is a 50 hertz. That is, each cycle is 1/50th of a second. In half cycle, it is 1/100th of a second. So, in 1/100th of a cycle, the electron can move 10 to the power minus 5 into 1 by 100, that is about 10 to the power minus 7 meters. Suppose the area of cross section of the wire is 10 to the power minus 3 meter square. Imagine now an element of length 10 to the power minus 7 meters at the end of such a wire. The volume of this element would be 10 to the power minus 7 into 10 to the power minus 3, 10 to the power minus 10 meter cube. I will show you here. This is the wire, and we are concentrating on this section, the end of the wire, whose length is 10 to the power minus 7 meters. That is the distance covered by electrons in 1/2 cycle. Okay? And the cross section we have chosen is 10 to the power minus 3 meter square, so that the volume is 10 to the power minus 10 meter cubed. On this, suppose the electrons move first in this direction, for first half cycle in this direction, for the next half cycle, let them move in this direction. Now, the number density of free electrons in a metal like copper, so suppose we have a copper wire, the number density is 10 to the power 29 per meter cube, m to the power minus 3. Therefore, in this volume, 10 to the power minus 10 meter cube, the number of electrons would be 10 to the power minus 10 into 10 to the power 29, that is 10 to the power 19. So, the number of electrons in this volume is 10 to the power 19. You can see it is a huge number. And in half cycle, all the electrons just move from the wire to the outer circuit, to the bulb in this case. For the next half cycle, 10 to the power 19 electrons would move from this end to the bulb. So, for first half, the electrons move from this end, and for the next half cycle, the electrons move in the opposite direction, that is, they move from this end to the bulb. Which means what? Which means that in both half cycles, the bulb is always getting the current, because the electrons are flowing through the bulb. Therefore, the bulb is always getting the current. So, when moving to the left, all these electrons can enter the bulb in a half cycle. In the next half cycle, when they are moving to the right, an equal number of electrons can enter the bulb from the other end of the wire. So, there is current in the bulb in both halves of the cycle. The bulb does not care about the direction of the current, because the heating effect by which the bulb glows does not depend on the direction of the current. So, it glows in both halves. At exactly the end of a half cycle, the bulb receives no current and does not glow. You see, for half cycle, the electrons flow. For half cycle, the electrons flow, but at the moment between the two half cycles, at this moment, there is no current through the bulb. So, the bulb does not receive current at just the end of the half cycle. The bulb receives no current and does not glow. But this happens so briefly, you see, that is only an instant, and then the current goes to the negative half. So, it happens so briefly and so fast, how fast? 50 times per second, that the persistence of vision makes us feel as if the bulb is glowing all the time. So, although the current is going for 1/2 cycle in this direction, for the next half cycle in this direction, and just at the end of the half cycle, there is no current in the bulb. But this happens so fast, it happens 50 times per second, and happens for such a brief time that we feel as if the bulb is glowing all the time. Since an alternating current varies in time, it causes variation in the magnetic field it produces. You see, we have already seen that if there is a current through a wire, or if there is a current through a loop of wire, there is a magnetic field. And if the current changes constantly for one half in this direction, for the next half in this direction, then the direction of the magnetic field also changes, which means there is a change of flux. And because of Faraday's law and Lenz's law, there is a production of an EMF which is in the direction opposite to the direction in which the current is flowing through a wire. Such a production of EMF is called back EMF. It resists the flow of current through the wire because of Lenz's law. Now we have a situation in which a time varying current such as AC in a current induces an EMF in itself. It means incidentally that to show induction effects we do not need two circuits. Remember, in the last few lectures we have been saying if there are two loops, then if one is moved or the other is moved, there is relative motion between the two, there is induction effect. But in a single wire there can be induction effect if the direction of current is changing. Now let us consider a solenoid of length L, area of cross section A and total number of turns N. If it carries a current I, then the magnetic field is given by mu 0 n by L times I. That is the magnitude of the magnetic field. The flux due to this field is, if there are n turns, n times B times A. Area is a cross section of the solenoid. So, phi, the flux is n B A, which is mu 0 A n squared by L times I, if I substitute the value of B from the last equation, mu 0 n by L times I. So, if I substitute that, I will get this expression. We may write this equation as phi equal to L times I, you know, this is a constant term. So, I can write phi equal to L times I, where L is this term, mu 0 a n squared by L. So, L is mu 0 a n squared by L. This L is called self-inductance. Why? Because it is this thing that resists the increase of current in the circuit. Therefore, this is called self-inductance. By Faraday's law, the induced EMF is given by epsilon equal to minus d phi by dt. If I substitute phi from here, I get minus L times di by dt. That means L is given by the magnitude of epsilon, that is the EMF, divided by the rate of change of current. The negative sign in the above equation is due to Lenz's law. We have discussed it several times, which implies that the induced EMF should be in such a direction that it opposes the source that produces it. If it were not so, the implied positive feedback would lead to a non-physical situation of ever increasing current in the circuit. You see, what is meant is this: there is a current through a coil, and if this variation in the direction of the current through the coil increases the induces the EMF, which is in the same direction as the, which produces current in the same direction as the actual current, then the current goes on increasing. That means current will become infinite, which is obviously not possible because this is a violation of law of conservation of energy. Therefore, the EMF induced must be in the backward direction. That is why it is called back EMF. The expression for the self-inductance for a coil is equal to mu 0 a n squared by L shows that it depends only on the geometry of the coil. You see, it depends upon A, which is the area of cross section of the coil, n, the number of turns, L, the length. So, it depends only on the shape of the coil. Since self-inductance opposes the increase of current in a circuit, as we just discussed according to Lenz's law, it acts like a resistance. In the context of AC, this resistance is called reactance and it is noted by X. You know, resistance is noted by R, then reactance is denoted by X. We have just seen that the self-inductance of a circuit resists an attempt to increase the current in the circuit. Likewise, it resists any attempt to decrease the current in the circuit. Does not allow the current to be increased, this Lenz's law, and it does not allow the current to be decreased. Both ways, it acts in the direction opposite. This is similar to the role played by mass in resisting any attempt to change the state of a linear motion of a system. You know, if there is a linear motion, if you want to change its state of motion, then mass offers resistance. Similarly, if you want to arrest the motion of this, again the mass or inertia of the system would resist this change in the state of motion. In a rotatory motion, it is the moment of inertia which plays that part. So, inductance in electrical circuit plays the same part as inertia and moment of inertia in linear and rotatory motions. Now, suppose we have to establish current I in an inductor. You see, we start with zero current and then we want to establish current I in the inductor. Obviously, we have to do work against the back EMF, because as soon as we try to increase the current, there is a back EMF which tends to reduce the current. That means we have to supply energy to the inductor from outside sources. The rate at which energy is supplied, that is power, is equal to V times I or E times I, where I t is the current at a given moment t. So, I can write I as L di by dt, E as L di by dt. Therefore, the rate at which work is done or energy is supplied is I t L di t by dt. The total energy supplied is U equal to from initial state to final state p t dt. And if I substitute for p t, I will get L is constant. So, it goes out, it becomes I t times di. So, I di is I squared by 2. So, the work done or the energy supplied to the inductor is half L I squared. This energy goes into the magnetic field of the coil. Now, suppose we have two coils, and if we say start current in this, then there is a current in this. We have seen that earlier also. And if there is a current, if we stop current in this, then again there is a EMF generated in this. So, this effect is called mutual inductance. That is, this, the establishment of current in this or switching off of current in this induces EMF in this coil or vice versa. This kind of effect is called mutual inductance. And Lenz's law implies that the direction of the induced EMF in coil B should be such that it opposes the change sought to be produced in the magnetic field due to changes in coil A. Again, the thing that we have been doing so far. The phenomenon of induction in a coil due to changes in current in a neighboring coil, if I change current in this and the neighboring coil has the induction effects, this is called mutual induction. This is also measured in the same units, Henry's, in which the self inductance is measured. Suppose the primary coil has n PRI turns and length L. The magnetic field due to this is mu 0 by L into n times I, n primary times I primary. The same field is linked to the secondary coil. If I have one coil and another coil is wound on the same one, then the same field is linked to the secondary coil. And therefore, the flux linked to the secondary coil is n secondary, where n secondary is the number of turns in the secondary coil, into B, which is this, into area of cross section. Area of cross section will more or less be equal if one coil is wound over closely over the other coil. And therefore, phi sec, the flux linked to the secondary coil, would be mu 0 a n sec n primary divided by L into this. And this quantity is again constant, which I can write as m. So, phi sec is m times I primary, m times I primary, the current in the primary in this one. This is the thing, we produce current in this or reduce current in this, then the effect is felt in B. So, phi sec I can write as m times I primary. Therefore, m is mu 0 a n sec n primary by L, this quantity. This is called mutual inductance. The induced EMF in the secondary coil again by Faraday's law is epsilon sec equal to minus m times dI primary by dt. That is, if I change current in the primary circuit, then there is induced effect, induced EMF in the secondary circuit, that is given by minus m times this, right. Here the derivation of m is for complete coupling, that is this coil being completely surrounded by this coil. If coupling is not complete, then of course m is not as strong and the induction effect also is not as strong. If the current varies with frequency omega, then the magnitude of the induced EMF is given by epsilon into L equal to L times dI by dt, and dI by dt is omega. Therefore, epsilon is I times L times omega, dI by dt is I omega, so L times I times omega. And this quantity L omega, you can see, is epsilon by I or V by I. So, this has the same significance as the resistance. Therefore, this is known as the reactance of the inductor XL, which is equal to L omega. And the circuit element is shown like a coil, an inductor is shown like a coil, a resistor, you know, is shown like this, and an inductor is shown like a coil. But this should not, here I give the, I have shown both resistor as well as the inductor. And XL versus omega, XL is L omega, therefore increases with omega, XL increases linearly with omega. The reactance of an inductor L omega increases linearly with the frequency omega of the AC, and this is the resistor, this is the inductor, these are the symbols, and this is a symbol for the varying current, varying voltage. Since inductance is like, it has a reactance which acts like resistance, then the inductances can be added when they are in series, and when they are in parallel, as in this case, they are added like this, 1 by L, the effective inductance is equal to 1 by L1 plus 1 by L2 plus 1 by L3, as in the case of resistances. For future reference, the reactance of a capacitor is 1 by C omega, where C is the capacity of the capacitor and omega is the frequency of the AC. And this I have shown by a graph, XC varies as 1 by omega. Now, we have shown by coil the inductor. It should not give the impression that only a coil produces inductance. Even a straight wire can have inductive effects. See, there is a current in the wire and you switch off the current or switch on the current, what happens? Magnetic field changes and therefore there is a back EMF. If there is a back EMF, there must be inductance also. Even a straight wire can have inductance, maybe small, but it can have inductance. So, the symbol should not mislead you. The symbol is this, but the inductance can be there even for a straight wire. Now, since alternating current, you know, this is the alternating current I have been showing you, and since this varies in time, so what happens? This is a sine curve, therefore the average is 0. Area of this half cancels with this half, so therefore the average is 0. So, we cannot deal with current, with the currents or voltages varying like this. What we have to do is to square them. Instead of sin omega t, we have sin square omega t. And sin square omega t has the average 0.5. You see, this plus this area is equal to this plus this plus this area. So, the sin square omega t, the average is half. So, the average of the square of a sine or cosine function over one cycle does not vanish, its value is half. You can in fact see that, you can integrate sin squared omega t. So, the average will be 1 by 2 pi integral of sin squared omega t dt. So, you can see that, that it is equal to half, you can easily verify. So, this means that we have to deal not with the current or with the voltage varying as like this, we will have to deal with the square and then the root of the square. That means we have to deal with root mean square quantities. Instead of I, which varies as sin omega t, we shall use I RMS value, which is maximum value Im divided by root 2, and similarly for the voltage. So, we will have to deal with what are known as root mean square values, and you are familiar with these root mean square values from the kinetic theory. You know, there you remember that the kinetic energy or the temperature etcetera is related to the thermal motion of the particles of the gas, and we take the root mean square velocity. Half mv squared is actually the square, v square is the square of the root mean square value. So, to remind you, if three molecules have velocities 1, 2 and 4 units, the mean square value, first of all we find squares, then we take the mean, and then we take the square root. That gives us the RMS value. So, if three molecules have velocities 1, 2 and 4, this you must have done in fact we did that in the kinetic theory of gases. The mean square value is 1 plus 4 plus 16 by 3, and the average is equal to 7. Therefore, the root mean square value is root 7. So, since the currents and the voltage would vary in sinusoidal fashion, we cannot deal with them as such, because the average becomes 0. This area cancels this area. We have to deal with the square of these quantities. When you plot the square, you can see that the square, the average value of the square of these quantities is half. You can show mathematically also, but graphically you can see that the value is half. And therefore, the average of squares has some meaning. The average of the quantity itself has no meaning, because the average becomes 0. Therefore, we take the average of the square, and then we take the mean value, and then we take the square root to give us the quantity. So, such values are known as root mean square values, and therefore, we shall deal with root mean square values, and as I have shown in an example here, the root mean square value of three molecules having velocities 1, 2 and 4 is root 7 units. So, we shall be dealing with root mean square quantities. In the next lecture, we will continue with the alternating currents, and we shall see what happens when we have a circuit which contains R and L, or C and L, or C and R, or L, C and R, all three together. We shall continue with the discussion.